Well, we're glad you're here today. We have a full day today, so we are so pumped that you're here. But the biggest thing we want you to be excited about today is we're here to hear from the Lord. God is going to speak to us today. There's an amazing message, and the word today is just so powerful. You know, the gospel is such a blessing, and it's so much bigger than we can imagine. And so today I just wanted to cap off this series, not that it's the end, but really it is. What you were going to learn today is something God did die to give us, and it's such a blessing to us. But I promised you last week, again, if you're new with us, last week was Resurrection Sunday, Easter. We had an amazing day, nine water baptisms. Isn't that powerful? Nine people got water baptized. And if you take out 400, I'll be okay. 500, somewhere in there. There you go. And then we had 10 people give their life to Jesus, 4 kids, and 6 in our services. And so just an amazing day all together. And I also told you if we hit 450 that I'd go in the dunk tank. And so without a drummer, we'll do a leg roll. All right, there you go, leg roll. 459. There we go, we did it. So 459. So I'll be in the tank at 1:30. At 1:30, myself and the pastors, because they're not going. If I'm going down, they're going down too. All right. So they'll be in there with me, and so you can have fun and let your frustration out on me as your pastor for all pastors around the world. Just let it out. All right. There you go. But we'll be out there. It'll be fun. But we've got so many great things today. We just want to celebrate. All through the Bible, Jesus celebrated. There was feasts, 7 feasts a year the Jews celebrate. The Lord, of course, in heaven, I don't know if you knew this, he'll be bringing one of the feasts back, the Feast of Booths, Sukkot. We'll be celebrating in heaven. It's going to be a powerful, powerful eternity with God. It's going to be amazing. We won't be disappointed, I promise you. But today, we wanted to just have a little slice of heaven on earth today, and we're just going to have a blast. We're going to have a dunk tank. We've got an inflatable. We have Mission Barbecue for you barbecue lovers. There's Mission Barbecue. If you're addicted to their mac and cheese, because that's like, whatever addiction you think. But we'll have a lot. You can eat a lot of mac and cheese, so it'll be fun. So we're just going to have a blast with that. Also, there is a petting zoo coming, so you can pet a llama if that floats your boat. All right, pet a llama, have a blast. And so just get some photos. But the biggest thing is, let's just be one body together. Let's have fun together. Let's serve Jesus together. Let's worship together. Let's receive from him. And let's just have some fun of laughter and enjoy. And it's going to be well over 80, so the complexion of all of you will be greater after today, right? We'll lessen some of your complexions. It'll be great. So it'll be a good day, all right? Today we were going to do our It's Me series, and if you've got your Bibles, you can turn to John chapter 20. We'll be in John 20, 21, and Acts 2, all right? So you're really close if you're in any of that area. If you've got your Bibles, you can turn there, your phones, or you can join me on the screens as well. It'll be great. Now, I did have a surprise for you today, and I don't know if it's going to happen yet, so let me look at my phone. He was going to let me know at 11:30, which it is right now, so I'm not sure. But we did schedule a hot air balloon to be here, so you can do a 100-foot tethered ride. But the wind has to be just right. So as of this morning, it was a little too heavy for the balloon. But so if a balloon shows up, all right, it's for you, okay? It's for you. I don't know if he will, but if he does show up, that's for you. You can take a tethered ride. If you have a fear of heights, we will free you of it today, all right? You will go up. The rope will stop you, and you'll come back down. Not the ferry, but it'll be fine. So I don't know if he's going to be here, but that was our surprise, and everything just has to work out right. But even if it doesn't come, it's going to be a blessing together. Amen? All right. It's me. It's me. Not me specifically, but this series is all about where Jesus just shows up in your life. He has a remarkable way of doing that, even today in 2022, but thousands of years ago as he resurrected. I mean, imagine this. He's dead. He's in a tomb. He raises from the grave. But one of my favorite moments of Jesus is that he appears for 40 days. For 40 days, he's just showing up. Hey, guys, it's me. How many of you would freak out if a dead guy got out of the grave and just said, how you doing? It's me. That's what this series is all about. Listen, Jesus hasn't stopped saying it's me. It's different, I know. He's not on earth anymore. He's still alive. He's still Lord. He's still God. He's still ruling from heaven at the right hand of the Father. He's still doing all of those things. And by the way, he still does these it's me moments. But he promised you it would be a little bit different. part of the communion you take, right? The bread and the blood. The blood is the covenant that I am going to send you God himself, the Holy Spirit, to help you. And that's what today's all about. Today's message is called The Door. Now, if you've been with us through the whole series, it started off on Palm Sunday with the gates. We all walked through the gates as Jesus walked through the gate on Palm Sunday. We learned how Jesus showed up and people began to worship. He showed up in the synagogue and he healed people. Just an amazing moment in history. Last week, we showed up on Good Friday and it was about the cross. We all went out to the 16-foot cross. We had communion together. We worshiped God together. We honored him for his sacrifice. And then on Easter Sunday, we walked into an empty tomb. We worshiped in a tomb. If you were with us, we had the stone rolled away and you walked in and we worshiped in an empty tomb. And today, the door. Now it makes no sense, does it? The door. Makes no sense. But Jesus, there was a time in John chapter 20 where the disciples, and if you could imagine in history, the Romans and the Jews and many people, they cried out, crucify, crucify, crucify. And Jesus did die on the cross. They made sure of it. They'd emptied out his blood. They poked him with a spear and everything came out. He was dead, for sure dead. They put him in a tomb. They put guards outside the tomb. If you remember last week as we read, they put guards out there to make sure, because they were all concerned that somebody would take the body. So the Romans put guards, and listen, this isn't like they just put guards and you could sneak around the guards. If someone stole the body, the guards would be dead. Right. That's how serious the Romans took it. There was no somebody sneaking in and stealing the body. So when Jesus got up out of the grave, it says in the scriptures that the guards fell over like dead men. Let me tell you, when they woke up, they were dead men already. But when Jesus woke up and got out of the grave, that's not news that the Romans or the Jews wanted to hear. Not only did he wake up, not only did he get up, but he started appearing to people. Now, the fake news was, to put it in our context today, the fake news was they told everybody that somebody took the body. Somebody took the body. They came up with this great scheme that it was stolen. But that kind of spoils it when they say someone stole the body and Jesus is like, hey, how you doing? Now, the Romans, the government, the Jews, obviously irate, weren't they? They killed him. They did not want this news of the risen Messiah that's appearing to people. And by the way, Jesus didn't just appear to the disciples. In Acts, it tells us he appeared to thousands of people, believers, unbelievers, government officials. So what's the only thing you can do when your spoil is planned, especially when you're in power and you don't want anybody to know that Jesus is alive? You manipulate, you use your power, and you use fear tactics. And so for the believers in Christ, which there was only a few at this moment, maybe 100 or more. Now, Jesus obviously healed people. There were crowds of people. We don't know exactly all who believed. But when we look at the core, there was 100 people in the upper room. And the pressure from government, from Romans, from the Jews was to fear them, to stop them, to stifle them, to make sure that this word didn't get out. And so if that was you, in fact, maybe it is you today. Maybe you're full of fear. Maybe you're sitting here. I mean, we've went through 2 years of craziness. Some of you are joining us today for the first time in a couple years. It happened around Easter, 2 years ago. Some of you have just started joining back. After 2 years, you've been worshiping Jesus live again for a couple times. Some of you right now, you're online. By the way, students, thank you for shooting the cameras. I'm not easy to follow, so just hang in there. But for some of you, fear, you understand fear. Maybe you locked yourself down in your house. Maybe you carry a weapon. Because of fear, you've stopped hanging around groups of people because of fear. I mean, our kids, our young people have paid the price of figuring this out. But my first point today is this. It's me. Even when you're full of fear, it's me. In John chapter 20, the disciples were hiding in the room, it says. In verse 19, it says, that Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. So I thought we'd have some fun. That's why it's called the door. They locked the doors. Go ahead, ushers. Lock it up. Lock it up. There you go. Locked. Nobody's getting in. They made sure nobody was getting in. And rightfully so. I mean, they would have been killed. They just crucified Jesus. They're next on the block. They were afraid. It's me. Even in these fearful moments. You know, a few, maybe it was a year ago now, we had a lady that started coming to services and new to the church, started coming, but she kept asking for prayer. She was being stalked. Legitimately, it was a terrible thing, being stalked. But she just began to ask for prayer and just saying, hey, I need this to stop. So much so, she had to sell her house and move. She had to go to court. And I remember in those moments just praying with her, not just me, like we had the intercession teams praying over her. And finally, there was a moment where Jesus said, it's me. Took this man away. Wasn't allowed, imprisoned him, wasn't allowed to stalk her any longer. The fear went away. Listen, if that's you today, maybe you're like the disciples, maybe you're like this woman, you're just locked up in fear. I just want to encourage you, because Jesus spoke a lot about how he can help you in these moments. In fact, it says in John chapter 14, verse 27, let me read the whole passage first so we can be in kind of agreement and just hear what God said. Verse 19 said, that Sunday evening, the disciples were behind the locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them. Peace be with you. Now, many times when angels appear or Jesus appeared, especially as a resurrected Jesus or an angel just appeared, what do they say? Don't be afraid. That's what they used to say. This time, Jesus says, peace. Peace be with you. Why? Because the fear was in the person. And Jesus said, peace be with you. And he spoke and he showed them the wounds in his hands and his side. They were filled with joy and they saw the Lord. Again, he said, peace be with you. Twice. That's how fearful they were. Twice, Jesus had to give them something they didn't have in the moment. As the Father sent me, I am sending you. Then he breathed on them and said, rejoice, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they're forgiven. If you don't forgive them, they're not forgiven. This is the first time salvation is given, by the way. Jesus ascended to the Father in two different situations. It's another sermon in itself. And he came and he brought salvation to disciples for the first time. This wasn't receiving the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. That's a whole different experience. But the disciples, for the first time, their sins were forgiven. They've now been washed, and the seal of the Holy Spirit sit upon them for the first time. This is when history changed for all of us. It's when it changed for them. Jesus also spoke to them in John 14 as he walked in and said, peace. And again, they're full of fear. But in John 14, he taught them before he went to the cross. He said this, peace I leave you with you. My peace I give to you. Now listen to this. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled. Let it neither be afraid. When Jesus gives peace, it's not like anything you can understand in the world. Look, you can buy a weapon. You can live behind locked doors. You can do all the things, and none of those things are bad for any reason. You know, there's wisdom. There's things that we should do. There's things that we should do to be wise. There's things that we should do to align ourselves. But what I'm telling you is, you can't, even if you do all of those things, you'll never have the peace of God. There's a peace that Jesus gives that you can't get in the world. You can't download it. You can't buy it. It's only found in him. And he says, I'm giving you peace. So when he showed up to those disciples and he said, peace be with you, and peace be with you again, he was giving them something that they couldn't find, even though they were locked behind a door, even though they were in a safe room. Jesus literally walked through the door without opening it. It's me, guys. I'm here to give you something. There's another scripture in Philippians. Paul teaches us about peace. He says this. He says, don't worry, or another translation says, don't fear about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need. Thank him for all he's done. Then, only then, this is a formula, by the way. I'll go over it in a second. Then you will have peace which exceeds anything you can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And if you've ever received peace from God, that's one thing that it does. It gives you peace in your heart. It gives you peace in your mind. And it surpasses your understanding of, like, I can do it myself. I know we're people that we can take care of ourselves. But there's many aspects in your life where you just need Jesus to help you. And when you're locked in fear, peace is one of them. Here's the formula. And the formula works every time because it's the Word. The formula works every time. Now, there's a lot of things in faith like that we want to try to figure it out. Maybe it's works or maybe it's this or that. And look, we kind of get confused and mess it up. But this one works every time. Here's the formula for peace. It says, don't let fear overcome you. Don't let it. It's a choice. You know, my pastor always says it in this way, and I've heard many pastors say it, and I've always remembered it. Anytime you make a decision out of fear, you'll regret it. You'll regret it. Now, I'm not trying to be harsh or mean or unkind, because listen, Jesus experienced fear too. If you remember when he was in the garden, he said, Lord, if this cup can pass, let it. Look, he was experiencing fear. But what did he say after that? Not my will be done, yours. You see, a lot of times we let fear overcome us in such a way that we allow it to change how we live, how we worship, how we treat people, how we don't treat people, how we don't even engage with people. Fear is a crazy thing that the enemy uses because fear is not of God. Now, it's not that God hasn't experienced it, because he's experienced every temptation. Fear is one of those things he's experienced. But the formula is this: don't let fear overcome you. Pray. Just pray. Just talk to me. Tell me what you need. This is the formula. Don't let fear overcome you. Pray. Tell me what you need, and then thank him for what he's done. Thank him for what he's done. Be grateful. Be thankful. Even if you're in a place of total fear, you can say, God, thank you that you are protecting me. Thank you that your peace surpasses my understanding, which is the very next verse. And it guards my heart and it guards my mind. That's the formula. Don't let fear overcome you. Make a choice that says, I'm not going to make this decision because I know I'm afraid. Because I know I have fear. So I'm not going to make the decision based on how I feel. I'm going to pray. I'm going to talk to you. God wants you. He says it right here in Philippians. I want you to tell me what you need. Tell me what you're experiencing. Tell me what you're going through. Tell me what you're afraid of. And then honor him. Thank him. I love the song we ended with, gratitude, right? Find a place to be grateful. God, I'm right here. I do feel fear. I sense it. I'm experiencing it. But I thank you that no weapon formed against me will prosper. You've got to stand on Scripture. You've got to stand on the Word. You've got to know that you have a God that loves you. And to be honest, and I'm not trying to wash things away, but our eternal resting place isn't here on earth. It's with Jesus. God has a huge plan for you. Don't be overcome by fear. Second thing Jesus taught us about it's me is he loves to show up in just everyday things. Everyday things. Everyday life. It's me. Jesus loves to just show up in your life with in everyday moments. And you know, how many of you guys like to fish? Any of you like to fish? How many of you like someone else to fish, right? But you like to fish. Well, the disciples were fishermen, right? Before they met Jesus, that was their occupation. They fished. And if you've ever been to Israel and been to the Sea of Galilee, it's fruitful of fish still today. It's amazing how fruitful that sea is. But they loved to fish. Now, when you get stressed or you get anxious or, again, now the Bible says don't be anxious for anything, but one of the things that as human beings we like to do is there's something that comforts you. Do you have something that comforts you? Maybe you just like to go out into the wilderness, take a walk, breathe in the fresh, unpolluted air. You know, just get out in the woods, go down a trail. Maybe you like to go fish. That could be one of your things. Man, I just need to go fishing. I just need to get out there. How many of you have comfort foods? Anybody have comfort foods? You know you do. Maybe it's barbecue. You're ready for today, right? Biscuits and gravy. That country fried steak that, no, it's taken a year off your life, but I'm going to have it anyway. We need it anyway, right? Comfort foods. We all have things that we do to comfort us. We even have friends that we talk to or hang out with, or we call when we're going through things, and that's a good thing. Well, in Scripture, this is, you know, obviously they have all this pressure and all this tension, and there's fear, there's anxiety, there's all these things, but watch this, and watch how God, not only does he care that you have fear and he wants to give you peace, but he also cares about things that you care about. A, he made you, and A, he understands these things, but he cares about just the everyday thing. Sometimes we think we go through life and God doesn't understand, or he's not part of our lives, or he's not paying attention. Oh, he's paying attention. Look at John chapter 21. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. And on this way, he showed himself Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana and Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. So there's a crew of people there. Simon Peter said, I'm going fishing. I just need to go fishing. I just need to get away. Now watch this. Watch the others that are around them. They said, we're going with you also. We need to go fishing too. Look, that was their comfort. That was their place. They just needed to get out on the boat. They went out and immediately got into the boat, and watch the words. The words are intentional and purposeful. They got into the boat, and that night, so it's clear, they went out. Maybe at dusk, at night, they went out, they caught donuts, nothing, zero. But when the morning had come, that's all night they're fishing. They're out all night. And the morning had come, Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know who it was. They said to him, children or fellows, have you caught any fish? No, they replied. And he said to them, cast the net to the right side of the boat. Do you think that they didn't cast it to the right side of the boat? I mean, if you fish, you know, you throw it here, you throw it there. You try to find every hole you can to catch fish, right? So do you think they didn't throw it on that side? You know they did. The miracle isn't on what side of the net is. The miracle is that God's over everything. So if he tells the fish, swim along over there, my friends, they're going. So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it because of the multitude of fish. Now watch this. Therefore, the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. And watch this. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, and he removed it and plunged into the sea. He jumped in. But the other disciples came into the little boat, for they were not far from land, but about 200 cubits, dragging the net with fish, that as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire of coals there. And fish laid on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you've caught. Simon Peter went up and dragged the net to the land full of large fish. Listen to this. Full of large fish. 153 fish. Now you know how it works. I think all of us know how it works, even if you don't fish. I caught a fish that big. Right? That big. It's like when my wife sees a spider. Right? It's that big. It's a little tiny. But 153 large fish? How many of you know they remember that fishing trip? One time I went fishing, I caught 153 large fish. Well, I didn't really catch them. Jesus said, get in the net, and they got in the net. But still, there was 153 large fish in there. Come and eat breakfast. Yet none of the disciples dared to ask him, who are you? Because they knew that it was the Lord. Jesus then came and took the bread and gave it to them, and likewise the fish. This is now the third, it's me. It's the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. Look, whether you're a fisherman, whether you're a mom, a dad, whether you're an engineer, a nurse, a teacher, whether you're a teenager, a student, a young person, a child, God cares about what who you are and what you're doing. He cares about every moment. He cares about everything you're good at, everything you're not good at. He cares about it all. You know, when I read this scripture and I read this moment, it encourages me for many reasons, because I don't know about you, but I've said many times in my life, like, does God even care? Does he even know what's going on? And this encourages me because the disciples just needed a break. They just needed a rest. They needed to go fishing. They just needed to get out of what was going on. They needed to be in their own space. And for them, that was comfort. And I don't know about you, but I need that. And God knows, he so knows that we all need that, that he created a principle a day that we forget about sometimes. You know what it's called? The Sabbath. It's not legalistic either. And it's not about what you do on that day. It really is about you resting in God. It's about this right here. It's about that it's me. God, I just need to be with you. There's a lot happening in my life. There's a lot happening in my family. There's a lot happening in school. There's a lot happening. Whatever it is, we need that rest moment. And God cares about that moment. He cares about you. Now, some of you read that, and I don't know about you, but I read it and I'm like, man, the disciples came in off the boat. Peter's diving in. The other ones are dragging the net up there. But I hope you caught that the fish was already ready. How did that happen? Did Jesus go fishing and catch a fish and put it on? Did the fish jump onto the fire all by itself? But the fish sandwich was already made. They came and it was ready. Now, I don't know about you either. I've never had fish for breakfast. But if Jesus is making fish sandwich for breakfast, I'm going to eat it. Because it's going to be good. You know it's going to be good. My point is, it's me. He cares about you. He cares about what you do. He cares about what you need. He cares about what you're afraid of, what you're fearful of. He cares about your kids, your family, your spouse, your marriage. He cares about even if you're in a broken relationship, even if you're full of sin, he cares. Why? Because he died while you were yet full of sin. He died in your place. He cares. But probably the most important message I come to give you this morning is the last point is, it's me, the Holy Spirit. Can I just tell you, the Holy Spirit is the most amazing person you're going to ever meet. Yes, he's a person. And yes, he's God. The Holy Spirit is God. I don't know what your experience is. Maybe you're sitting here going, oh no, this is going to go to a crazy place. The only craziness that it's going to go to is that you have a supernatural God that can do whatever he likes and pleases. And with him, all things are possible. You and I can't raise ourselves from the dead, but the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead is now in us. There's nothing to be afraid of, church. For the disciples, they received salvation, but then there was a moment called Pentecost, which was, Penta just means 50. Don't get all weird on me. It means 50. 50 days. 50 days after the Passover, it was when Pentecost was. It's that way every year. See, we say Pentecostal. It's really a weird term, isn't it? Because we're describing our behavior. We're describing something. But Pentecost means 50. So we're Pentecostal. We're 50. How crazy is that? Well, I'm a crazy 50. Well, good for you. It just means 50. It's a feast that celebrated Pentecost 50 days after Passover. But it's the day that the Holy Spirit, Pentecost, is known, because that's the day the Holy Spirit, for the first time, came into believers and dwelt with believers and lived for believers and will never leave or forsake believers. It's the first time. This is what Jesus died for. He died for your salvation, yes. He died so he could wash your sins, yes. He died so you could receive his righteousness, yes. But he also died because the covenant was that you're going to receive the Holy Spirit, and he's going to come in power, and he's going to lead, he's going to guide, direct, speak, rebuke, correct, whatever you need, he's going to be there for you. Amen. The Lord never said, hey, don't be afraid of the Holy Spirit. He's a weird dude. He said, you go and you wait in that room. You wait for him. You wait for him. And you're going to know when he comes. Church, you're going to know when he comes. For some of you like me, I didn't know the Holy Spirit. I was saved, but I didn't know the Holy Spirit. And this is not to make you feel bad. I just didn't know. I didn't know. Now, I knew there was a Holy Spirit. I knew that he was God, but I was confused on his responsibility or his role or his lordship in my life is really what I was confused about. I was confused that I could have a relationship with the Holy Spirit and it be dynamic and powerful and everything Jesus said it would be. And I was confused because I've seen a lot of weird things. I've seen people be weird. Listen, people will always be weird because we're people. And if you're thinking, well, I'm not weird, yeah, you're the weird one, trust me. All of us have a tendency to be weird. But that's not the Holy Spirit. He's perfect. Just like Jesus, he's perfect. There's no sin in the Holy Spirit. There's none of that, like, unhealthy. He's trying to hurt you. He's trying to deceive you. He's trying to get you to do something that is going to make you look a fool. In fact, what you see in the Bible about the Holy Spirit is any time that he's leading his people and the Holy Spirit is empowering you to do something, people notice. Not in a negative way. There's always going to be naysayers. We live in a fallen world. There's always going to be naysayers. But let me just show you in Acts chapter 2. And look, this was a unique experience with the disciples. I'm not saying that we're all in one room. We're all in one accord. It's not Pentecost yet because it's not 50 days after Passover, but that's okay. But Jesus died so you can have the Holy Spirit, a relationship with the Holy Spirit. Here's what it says in Acts chapter 2. One day, on the day of Pentecost, what's Pentecost mean? Thank you. 50 days after Passover. All the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly there was a sound from heaven like a roaring of a mighty storm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. Now some of you are like, well, that's just weird, John. No, it isn't. They're explaining what it was like. So a lot of times we think like, it says here that it presented, it was filled, and it began to speak in other languages. They began to speak in tongues. Listen, tongues can be a lot of things. But let me just tell you, it's always supernatural. It wasn't like they watched what's the internet software where you learn language? Babel or whatever. It's not like they were watching that for a year and they learned all these languages. No, no, no. Instantaneously, the Lord gave them a foreign language. Instantaneously. And that could happen. We have one of our missionaries we support, Mark Simpson, received Spanish and a doctorate level instantly from the Holy Spirit. Instantly. It still happens today, church. So let's keep going. And everyone presented filled and began to speak in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them the ability. Who gave them the ability? Thank you. And that time there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, not away. They came running. And they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. How can this be? They exclaimed. They are people. They are from Galilee. And yet we hear them speaking in our own language and our own native languages. How can that be? Anybody in here grow up not in America, somewhere else? Anybody? From another country, right? You have not only a language, but you have a dialect. In America, we're all messed up. Like, we got yins and all that stuff. Makes no sense up here in Pittsburgh. Going down to Dallas, hey, you got y'alls. You know, it's just, but you have your own dialect. You have your own way of communicating. How is it that I can walk in? And by the way, you can't just walk in and receive culture. You can't just walk in and receive dialect. When you live there, you grow up there, you know. That's us. That's Pittsburgh. Now, you can live here and you can learn it and you can grow, but this was instantaneous. The disciples received the Holy Spirit, began to speak in other languages and spoke clearly, perfectly in their dialect. They were amazed. How can this be? They're Galileans. They're Galileans. Now, watch. Here we are. And it lists a whole list of different societies, different cultures. Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, province of Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and areas of Libya, Cyrene, visitors of Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, 13, I believe, different nations. All and all, we all hear the people speaking in our own languages. Now, what did they say? That Holy Spirit's weird? No, they said about the wonderful things God has done. They stood there amazed and perplexed, and maybe you would be too if you were in that same situation. What can this mean? They asked. What could this mean? Who's saying that? The unbeliever saying it. Not the disciples. The unbeliever saying it. They say, what can this mean? How is it that these people, these Galileans, are speaking to me in my own language? What are they speaking? They started preaching the gospel. Peter gave the first sermon. Thousands of people got saved. Thousands of people not only received Jesus, but then were water baptized right after. Thousands of people, a room just like this. How can this be? What does this mean? This is what Jesus is speaking to you. It's me. Please hear me. The Holy Spirit loves you. It's me. I didn't receive the Holy Spirit till years after I was saved because I just didn't understand. I didn't know. And to be honest with you, I put up my own walls. I thought he was weird. I just didn't want what I saw. But every time I look in the scripture now, and this is what I would encourage you, every time you look at the Holy Spirit and when he fills believers, people get saved. People come running. People are amazed. Of course, there's some naysayers. Not everybody wants Jesus. Jesus wants everybody, but not everybody wants Jesus. So you're always going to have your naysayers. But I don't think that's why you're here, are you? You're here to hear from God, right? Some of you are skilled, gifted in a lot of different areas. But when the Holy Spirit, and look, if you remember when he spoke in language, it was as the Holy Spirit gave it to them. And that's always the way he operates. There's going to be moments, everyday moments, fear moments. There's going to be moments when the Holy Spirit comes and he helps you. And yes, it's going to bless you. It's going to bless you, but you know what? It's going to change people's lives. What do we say about that? What are we seeing? And by the way, it's always supernatural. It's above us. When God heals you from a sickness or a disease, we can't explain it, but the Holy Spirit can. When you receive a foreign language instantly, you can't explain it, but the Holy Spirit can. When you walk into a moment and you're ministering to somebody, look, at the end of the service, you'll come down and pray with somebody. Potentially, you'll come down and pray with somebody. And it happens often because the Holy Spirit is helping us. I don't even know you, but God will speak a word of prophecy over you, encouragement. Don't be weirded out, and don't turn away prophecy. Yes, test the word, sure. But when the Holy Spirit gives you a word through somebody, it's powerful. I have marked on my notes and my journals, etched in my brain moments where someone has spoke something over me and I knew it came from God. I'll remember it always. I'll tell people always. I was in a service just like this and God gave me a word I shared last week. It has changed my life forever because that's what God does. That's what the Holy Spirit does. Words of knowledge, things that people can't know about you. You walk into a service and I know we always come in with this idea, especially if we're running away from God. We come in thinking that everybody knows my junk. Everyone knows my stuff. That's why I can't come to church. It's a lie. It's not true. The truth is the Holy Spirit wants to help you. He wants to bless you. And maybe you are going through stuff. Maybe you are making wrong decisions. Maybe you did something stupid yesterday. It doesn't stop the Holy Spirit from saying, I love you and I want to help you. This morning, and I can give you scripture after scripture in Acts. Look, maybe you're here today and you haven't received Jesus. You can't have the Holy Spirit without receiving Jesus. It doesn't work that way. You have to start by receiving the Lord. Receive his salvation. In fact, when you get saved, just like what Jesus did, he breathed on them and they received the Holy Spirit. You're sealed by the Holy Spirit. You know, when you go to the movies, you have a ticket. You can't get in without her. You go to a show, you go to whatever, you have to have the ticket, the stub, right? Well, that falls way short of the Holy Spirit. But really, God knows who's saved and who isn't, because you have him inside of you. He knows. He knows. But then there's this empowering. There's this relationship. There's this love. There's this blessing that the Holy Spirit gives you, and he gives it to you at different times. One moment you may just have this burden and passion to lay your hand on somebody and pray healing over their body, healing emotionally, healing spiritually. You just may have a moment. One moment you may be praying over somebody and God gives you a word just to encourage them. You don't know what's going on, but you're faithful to give them the word. And that may be weird for a second, but this is what lordship is. Lordship is, I die to me and I hear you. And when I hear from you, especially from the Holy Spirit, you know, every gift of the Holy Spirit, I don't have time to go through all of them. Every gift is for somebody else. It's for somebody else. The only gift that's for you is for tongues. And tongues, heavenly tongues, not a foreign language. Heavenly tongues is to edify you, to encourage you. And if you have a tongue for somebody else, then it becomes prophecy. But it's translated. It's given. It's given so they can understand. It's spoken in a way that they can receive it. Otherwise, it's a clanging gong. But don't say you don't want it. It's God. And it's good for you. It's encouraging to you. It's edifying you. Every service before I walk up here, I pray in tongues because I want to receive from the Lord. It doesn't matter how long I pray. It doesn't matter how long I prepare. And that's important. But I ask the Lord, what do you want to say? Of course, I ask before then. But I always ask, do you want to change something? Is there something you want to do? Is there something you're speaking? I believe somebody in here today, right here, right now, is going to receive healing right here, right now. It doesn't necessarily have to be physical either. Maybe you're watching at home, you're online. Jesus is our healer. The Holy Spirit is our healer. You won't find sickness in heaven. In fact, when I said someone's going to heal you, really what I felt is you've got something going on in your head. Maybe you're just hard on yourself. Maybe you just beat yourself up. Maybe you're depressed. Look, peace be with you. Jesus wants to give you peace that you've never had before. This emotional head game that you've been playing is over. But you've got to receive it. Many times when Jesus approached people, he'll say, do you want to be well? If you don't want to be well, it's not that God doesn't want to heal you, but what's the point? Do you want to be well? Do you want to be free? Do you want to be healed? Here's the funny part. I can't help you. But God can help you. And that's what we do. I'm here to lead you to Jesus. I'm here to lead you to the Holy Spirit. Stand to your feet this morning. We're going to have a fun day. But before we have a fun day, I just want you to receive whatever God's saying to you. Every head bowed. Don't worry about your neighbor. Don't worry about your neighbor. If you need to be saved today, you haven't received Jesus, now's the time. Today's the day. And I don't care if you're a child, you're a teenager, you're an adult. If you need to hear Jesus, or you need to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, if that's you, just put your hand way up in the air. Come on, just say, hey, that's me. Thank you, thank you, thank you. There's many hands. Anybody else? Thank you, thank you. Starts there, my friends. You can receive the Holy Spirit and salvation at the same time, by the way. Acts tells us you can receive it later, you can receive it now. So all of this, that's the full gospel. That's everything. Jesus died so you can have salvation, so you can be healed, so you can be forgiven, and so you can have the Holy Spirit. But many of you in here need the Holy Spirit. You've been like me. You just pushed him away. Whatever the reason, it doesn't matter. God's not mad at you, but I'm just here to say you need to receive the Holy Spirit today. You need to receive him. This isn't salvation. What I'm talking about is a relationship with the Holy Spirit. If that's you today, like those that have committed their lives, and by the way, if you've committed your lives, say yes to both. I want salvation, and I want a relationship with the Holy Spirit as well. Amen. But if that's you today, you need the Holy Spirit, come on, put your hand up there. Those of you that need Jesus, put your hands up. Those of you that need the Holy Spirit, put your hands up. There's hands up everywhere. Come on. Lord Jesus, thank you, thank you, thank you. Where would we be without you? Come on, if that's you, put your hands up. Don't be ashamed. This is the moment. This is where everything changes. Lord, we need you. Holy Spirit, we need you. And we choose to receive you. Holy Spirit, right now, just fill. Save, fill, empower, give what only you can give to every person that's ready to receive. There's not anything I need to do. There's not any action you need to take. Simply open your heart and say thank you. Lord, we just want to do your work. Lord, I don't care if somebody's mad at me because I'm sharing about Jesus or sharing about the Holy Spirit. Lord, we want to be your church. We want to be your people. And we're going to need help along the way because we don't always know. But here's what I do know, God. There's a lot of hurting people out there. Whether I speak a foreign language, whether I speak a word of prophecy, or whether I speak a word of knowledge, I just want to be your voice piece. I want to be a repeater. I'm not here to make new things. There's nothing new under the sun. I'm here to repeat what you're saying to me. Give me the faith that when I see somebody and you give me a word or you give me something to lay hands on or pray over, or give me the faith to say I'll do it. Lord, faith is also a gift of the Holy Spirit. Give me the faith. Give me the faith. Let me be like Peter, that I'll preach and I'll teach. I'll give the word. Why? Not so people know my name, but so people know your name. So they'll get saved. Lord, we love you. Holy Spirit, we love you. It's in Jesus' name, everyone said. Amen. 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 Give them a big round of applause. Listen. Don't sit down yet. We got a long day. It's going to be a good day, by the way. But this is the best reason why you're here today, right here. If you gave your life to Jesus today or you received the Holy Spirit, please tell us. Please let us know. We're not going to embarrass you, but we just want to walk with you. We want to bless you. In fact, we have light bulbs at our other facility. This is our youth center. It's a little different, but we have light bulbs. You can plug that in next week. We'll put one aside for you next week. But commit to being in God's house every week. Make a commitment to be here, all right? All right?